Okay, so I think we can get started. So today I will tell you about geometry of gauge theory. And of course, this subject is very broad and made much progress in the last 30 years or so. And so I can tell you everything, but what I'm going to tell you about mostly is about the structure of configuration space of gauge theory. So we have already seen the notion of gauge field, which in the mathematical term refers to the means is about the connection of vector bundles. So we have connection, and suppose we have a vector bundle with the structure group G. That is that the vector bundle, so you have a base manifold over which you have a vector spaces. You have vector spaces. At each point on the base space, we have a vector space. And then group G is acting on it. So that means that vector space is a representation of this group G. So G is referred to as gauge group. So in this case, this A mu can be expanded in terms of the generator of gauge group. So this refers to, this means these are bases of B algebra of G. So last lecture we discussed the notion of Lie algebra, which is an infinitesimal version of gauge of Lie group G. And Lie algebra is a vector space, so we can choose a basis. So in the case of, suppose for example G is a unitary group, then T are Hermitian matrices. So TA is a basis of the Hermitian matrix. So if we are considering UN, then T is a basis of N by N Hermitian matrices. And so we can expand this gauge connection in terms of this basis. And so A itself is, for each component mu, A itself is a Hermitian matrix, N by N Hermitian matrix. Okay? So the covariant derivative would be this plus this, for example. And its commutator give rise to the curvature of this vector bundle, or in physics term called field strength. So it can be written in this way. So this is a field strength. This is the, in mathematical term, this is called curvature. In physics, it's called field strength. So in the case of Maxwell's theory, for example, this corresponds to electric field and magnetic field. If we are considering Young-Mills theory, then the Lagrangian density is given by something proportional to trace of F mu nu. So this is equal to trace of del mu A nu minus del mu A nu plus commutator of A nu square. And therefore the action is an integral of this object. In order to discuss the configuration space of this gauge potential, it is convenient to do splitting of time direction and space direction. Clearly, I'm going to talk about four-dimensional case, that is 3 plus 1 dimension, although it applies to any spatial dimensions. So but let's use the three-dimensional notation. So mu goes from 0, 1, 2, 3. So let's choose I to be the indices for the spatial direction. So I goes from 1 to 3. So with this decomposition, it's not so difficult to decompose these indices into spatial direction, time direction. So mu and nu are summed over. So sometimes mu is 0, sometimes mu is 1, 2, 3. So we can write this Lagrangian density with respect to that decomposition. And we find that it can be expressed in this way. It's a phrase of EI AI dot minus half of EI EI plus DI BI plus A naught C. So Lagrangian density takes this form. Okay, so let's see what it's telling us. Well, first of all, I have to say EI is equal to F0I. So this is an electric field, if you like. And then BI is a magnetic field. So it's a sort of dual of the spatial component F. Special component of it, like that. So this is electric, non-abelian version of electric field and magnetic field. These are still matrices, because we are considering non-abelian gauge theory. And C is given by del I EI plus AI EI, or we can write it as covariant derivative of E. If I use this notation, if I use a notation that del plus A is a covariant derivative. Okay? So this Lagrangian consists of three terms. So I forgot to say dot, A dot of I means it's a time derivative of A with respect to T. Now, if you remember the canonical formulation of classical mechanical system, then you may remember the relation between Hamiltonian and Lagrangian. So, namely, that Hamiltonian is related to the Lagrangian as PQ dot minus Lagrangian, which is a function of Q and Q dot. Or conversely, we can also write Lagrangian as PQ dot minus the Hamiltonian PQ. So this is a relation between Hamiltonian and Lagrangian. Now look at this one. So you see that, we see there is a term which corresponds to PQ dot, which is this term. So this shows that E and A are canonically conjugate to each other. If you choose AI as your dynamical variable, E, the electric field, will be its canonical conjugate momenta. Their canonical conjugate momenta. This term looks as though it is a Hamiltonian of this dynamical system, because this looks like square of the momentum. So this is just like the standard dynamical system, the Newtonian system, where you have momentum square term in the Hamiltonian. B square looks like potential term, because, well, what's B? Well, B is dual of Fij, and so that is epsilon ij k del I aj minus del j ai plus ai aj squared. So this is entirely expressed in terms of A and its spatial derivative. So this is just, this is something you can write. So if you think of P to be analogous to E and Q to be analogous to A, then this is expressed entirely in terms of A and its spatial derivative. So this is like a potential term. This will be a kinetic term. And this term E A dot tells you what are the relation between, canonical relation between E and A. One notable feature is that there is no time derivative of A zero component of the gauge potential. So there is a time derivative of A I, but there is no time derivative of A zero. So that means that A0 does not have its conjugate momentum. However, A0 do appear over here without time derivative. It is just multiplying to C. You might have heard the notion of Lagrange multiplier in canonical formulation of classical mechanics. That is that it's not a dynamical variable in the sense that it doesn't appear in the Lagrangian or Hamiltonian with time derivative. But it's there to enforce some kind of constraint. Because if you... So what the equation motion of the system is obtained by basically taking variation of dynamical variable, variation of action with respect to dynamical variable, and impose a stationary condition with respect to that variation. If you require, well, if you look at this, it's linear in A0, and the condition that action, which is an integral of Lagrangian density, to be invariant under infinitesimal variation of A0 simply says that C equals 0. So the entire raison d'etre of A0 is to enforce C equals 0. So it's a Lagrange multiplier. So this shows that E and A are conjugate to each other, and EI and AI are conjugate to each other, and A0 is a Lagrange multiplier. I'm going to the very right end of the blackboard. So if I write this in terms of equation, this means that we have a Poisson bracket for this system. Is if I put gauge group index I and time variable t and spatial coordinate x and AJA t, where when we talk about the Poisson bracket, we are considering equal time Poisson bracket, y Poisson bracket should be equal to delta ij, delta ab, and then three-dimensional delta function like that. So this would be the Poisson bracket relation that you can derive from this Lagrangian. Here, in order for me to say that it is normalized in this way, I have to assume that the basis that I have used to expand the gauge field has to be normalized in this way. With this normalization, the Poisson bracket becomes like that. And once we have Poisson bracket like that, then we can compute Poisson bracket of any other things that are expressed in terms of E and A. In particular, if I go to the left blackboard, you see that C is expressed in terms of E and A's. So we can compute the Poisson bracket of C's with itself, for example. So if I go to the right blackboard, so for example, we can compute the Poisson bracket of CA of X, of CB of Y. And then we see that this is equal to the structure constant of the Lie algebra that appeared in the last lecture, that if I compute the commutator of TA and TB, it is equal to I times FI FABC times TC, that F, the structure constant, times CC of X times the three-dimensional delta function. Okay? So this is good. This means that commit Poisson bracket of C with itself closes up to C. So in particular, it is consistent to impose a condition that C is equal to zero. If we look at what I have written on the blackboard in the middle, we see that the A0 is a Lagrangian multiplier which imposes a condition that C equals zero. And we just saw that condition, I'm going to the right, is consistent with the Poisson bracket relation between the C. So the kind of constraint that is consistent with the Poisson bracket like this are called the first class constraint. This is a terminology that was introduced by Paul Dirac, who studied the dynamical system with constraint. So these are called first class constraint. The first class constraint are constraints that are consistent with the Poisson bracket relation. We'll later encounter in this lecture the notion of second-class constraint. those are constraints that we inconsistent with Poisson bracket. And so then we'll see how those kind of constraints are used. But for now, I'm considering first class constraints that are totally consistent with the Poisson bracket relation. Okay. Now let's go to the left end of the blackboard. Okay, so what we have seen? Well, what we have seen is that we started out with this Lagrangian density, F mu nu squared, and we found that it consists of three terms, E times A dot, that's the first term, and then Hamiltonian density, that is, 1 half of E squared plus B squared, plus constraint, A naught times C. So Lagrangian consisted of these three terms. Okay. Now, so we can compute commutator between among the Poisson bracket of C's, and we saw that that's consistent. C with C went into C. Now, how about C with A? We can compute Poisson bracket of C with A, but actually it's more convenient. So let's compute instead the following thing. So let's introduce some parameter mu. Mu is a confusing notation. Oh, actually, yeah, I guess my notation wasn't so great in retrospect. I should not have used mu because I was using mu for the coordinate index. So let's write as rho. So rho is some function in three dimension times c of y. It's like that. Okay. Let's put index A here also. So let's consider something like that. And then if I compute the Poisson bracket of C with any component of the gauge field, then what you can show is that this is equal to del. This is equal to d mu of rho A, the derivative of A. In particular, for example, if you are considering Abelian gauge theory, it's just del mu of rho, which is a gauge transformation of A. And this is the sort of non-Abelian version of this. So this is del mu of rho A plus commutator of A mu and rho with index A. So this is a gauge transformation of A. So what this constraint does is to generate gauge transformation by Poisson bracket. So this is good. So this is interesting. So C does two things. One is that it has to vanish. But the other is that even though it is zero, but its commutator with gauge field is actually gauge transformation. But of course, we know that any physical observable in gauge theory has to be gauge invariant. So she has to be equal to zero is sort of related to the fact that physical thing has to be gauge invariant. In particular, Hamiltonian is gauge invariant because electric field and magnetic field are gauge invariant. And so in particular, it commutes with C. That is that the Poisson bracket of C, well, I'm actually using the terminology commute, although I should say Poisson commute, but I'm confusing the notion of Poisson bracket and commutator in the quantum version of this kind of system. But so when I inadvertently says commute, I mean Poisson bracket between these two things is zero. So anyway, Poisson bracket of C and E Hamiltonian is zero, which is the statement that Hamiltonian is gauge invariant.
Any question?
So, from this perspective, classical Young Mills theory is a constrained gauge, a constrained dynamical system with a generator C, which is constrained to equal to zero, and that generator generates the gauge transformation. And the zeroth component of gauge field is there just to impose that constraint as a Lagrange multiplier. Okay, so I would like to say more about sort of symplectic structure, the Hamiltonian structure of this gauge field configuration space. But before moving forward in that direction, it is a good idea to discuss some general feature of dynamical system with constraint. And so I first would like to discuss more generally classical dynamical system with constraint. And then after discussing that, we're going to come back to the Mills theory and apply notion developed here to understand the structure of configuration space of gauge field. So the main notion that I would like to discuss here is a notion of symplectic reduction. Sometimes this is called Marsden-Weinstein reduction, the Jerry Marsden, after Jerry Marsden, who just passed away in the last few weeks. So it is, let us try to review the notion, general notion of symplectic reduction. So suppose M is a general phase space. That means that it is a space of both coordinate and momentum. So naturally, it has to be even dimensional. And then this space is endowed with the notion of Poisson bracket. So we can explicitly have coordinate qi, pi, for example, where I goes from 1 to 2m. And if I choose that coordinate, then if I have any function of p and q, then we can define the Poisson bracket f and g by this kind of equation. Where I is a summed over. So this is a general notion of Poisson bracket. So when we have this kind of things, then we can define Poisson bracket in this way. But once we have that, we have defined it, we can change coordinate, and then this is still there. Okay. In particular, there is a notion of symplectic coordinate transformation. Which is basically the change of coordinate from PQ to another set of coordinate P tilde, Q tilde, but not any coordinate transformation, but coordinate transformation which preserves the form, this form of the Poisson bracket. So if I change, make a change of coordinate, of course we have to use the chain rule to rewrite the derivative operator in terms of P tilde and Q tilde. In general, the form of the derivative operator will change, but this shape, this expression should be preserved. This way of writing Poisson bracket should be preserved. And if you can do that, it's called symplectic coordinate transformation. Okay? So this is a phase space. Phase space is an even dimensional space endowed with this kind of symplectic, Poisson structure. Okay, so suppose we have this phase space. And suppose we have a Hamiltonian and also a set of first class constraints. So this is Hamiltonian. And then we have a set of constraints, phi A's, which are function of P and Q. So these are constraints. What am I writing? Constraints. But let's consider the case when they are of first class. Okay? So in particular, we require that they first class are consistent with Poisson bracket, so they should be closed and Poisson bracket. That is, that CA, CB commutes. There are too many C's, I'm afraid. So C's are constraints. These are, I should use different notation. So let's do D. D, ABC is some number, just like structure constant. And then this C is an index. I have three C on the right-hand side. Now I have only two C's or three C's. Anyway, so I see your point. You see my point, right? So C and C commute into C. And I also require that Hamiltonian is invariant, and I can require a stronger condition that H commutes, H and C do not, Poisson bracket of H and C vanishes, but we can have a little bit weaker condition that Poisson bracket of A and C is a linear combination of C. So for example, excuse me. These are not C's, I'm sorry, these are phi's. That's why I allowed myself to use C's, because these are phi's. So these are phi's. So phi for some bracket is equal to phi. H phi is phi. So that means that if I require phi to be zero, phi for some bracket is consistent with phi equal zero, and H and phi is equal to zero because phi is zero up by the constraint. So that means that phi is invariant under sort of transformation generated by phi. Well, I use a notation that transformation generated by phi, but by that I mean the following. I'm going to the right side of the blackboard. So suppose phi is some constraint which is a function of P and Q. And f is any function of p and q. Then if I compute Poisson bracket of phi and f, well, what you get is del q of phi times del f del p minus del p of phi del f del q. So it's actually a sort of linear combination of derivative of f in the direction specified by del phi and del q of phi and del p of phi. We can write it as some vector q, vector p del f del p plus vector q del f del q, where vector p is equal to del q of phi and vector q is equal to minus del p of phi. So this is as if you are taking derivative f in the direction of del q phi minus del p phi. So this is the direction that we are taking derivative of f. And for in particular, for example, if h is 0 and by this Poisson bracket, that means that h is invariant under in this direction. So this is the direction in the phase space that is generated by this constraint. So, for example, in the previous example of this gauge field theory, the Yang-Mills theory, we had a constraint which are C, and what we found was that Poisson bracket of C with gauge field is gauge transformation. Gauge transformation is the direction of the variation of gauge field generated by that constraint C. And so the statement there was that Hamiltonian or any other physical observable has to be invariant under that direction of variation. Similarly, so we say that if you use Poisson bracket, phi generates transformation, And H is invariant under that transformation, if this is the case. Okay, so if you have a Hamiltonian and constraint like that, it's natural to write the Lagrangian for this as Pi Qi dot. Dot is a time derivative minus Hamiltonian. Well, in my note, actually, P had lower index, Q had upper index, minus Hamiltonian, which is a function of P and Q, plus or minus the constraint, lambda A, phi A, where lambda is a Lagrange multiplier. So in the previous example of gauge theory, A0 are Lagrange multipliers. Oh, okay. Now, so question number one. So the question number one. Yes, so you know that I hope you are familiar or you have solved Hamiltonian equation of motion or Lagrange equation of motion. So use that knowledge to write down equation of motion for this system. With lambda A as arbitrary function. Of time t, and show if p and q is on phi equals 0 at t equals 0, then p t q t is on phi equals 0 for any t. Namely, phi equals 0 is consistent with the equation of motion. That if you set up the initial condition so that it satisfies the constraint, then solve the equation of motion with respect to this Lagrangian system, show in such a way that Hamiltonians commute or Poisson commute with the constraint, and phi commute with itself into phi commuting with phi into phi, then if you start with phi equals 0 surface, then it stays there. That's a question. Okay. So, like I said, in the case of gauge theory, phi generate gauge transformation in the sense that if you have any physical, any observables, functional or function of gauge field A, Poisson commutes that with the constraint C, you find that that is gauge transformation of that function. So if you want a physical observable in that case, you want that function or functional of gauge field to be invariant or Poisson commute with the constraint. That's generally the case, that if you have a constrained system, then physical observable better be Poisson commute with phi. And the reason for that is that Lagrange multipliers are something that is thought about artificial. It's just there to impose the condition that phi equals 0. However, if you have this Hamiltonian system, then if you consider some arbitrary function f, which are function of p and q, in general, its time evolution depends on Lagrange multiplier. It is only when f and Lagrange multiplier commute with phi, I have always a problem in saying this, because I like to say f and phi commute, so now I have to say f and for some bracket of f and phi is a linear combination of phi or something like that. If you have that, then the time development of f becomes independent of lambda. So I said it in words, so let me write some equation. So suppose f is a function of p and q. Okay? And suppose f, p and q develops according to the equation motion. Develop up according to equation motion. And then we can compute dd time derivative of f as a function of, which are function of p and q. Well, so this is equal to dp dt of del p of f and dq dt of del q of f. Now, equation of motion for p and q in general depends on the Lagrange multiplier. So that means that this would in general depend on Lagrange multiplier. But you can show that this is independent of lambda if the Poisson bracket of phi, f and phi, is equal to zero, or weakly equal to zero. That is, it is linear combination of phi itself. It can be expressed in terms of phi. So we say that if this is satisfied, f is physical. Physical observable has to satisfy this. If you have a set of first class constraints at phi equals zero, the physical observable better satisfy this. Otherwise, its time evolution depends on the Lagrange multiplier. In the case of gauge theory, this condition is equivalent to the condition that f is a gauge invariant function. Okay? So we have to impose, we would like to impose this additional condition that f Poisson commute with phi. So I'm going to the right end of the blackboard. So where we are? Well, so we started out with two m-dimensional space. So we have a phase space m, which has two m coordinates. So it is two m-dimensional space. And then we impose this condition. Suppose A goes from 1 to n. Suppose there are n constraints. Then this hypersurface where phi equals 0 is satisfied would be 2m minus n dimensional subspace. 2m minus n dimensional subspace. However, on this subspace, we would like to consider f qp as physical observables. That satisfies the property that the Poisson bracket of phi with f vanishes. That means that the del phi del qi del f del pi minus del phi del pi del f del qi is equal to zero. And then there are n of phi, n phi is like that, there. We can write it as v mu del mu of f is equal to zero, where v is a vector whose components are given by this derivative, namely del p of phi a and del q of phi a. Right? So that means that f is a function, but it's independent of particular direction of variation. And how many variations can you think of? Well, as many as phi's are. There are n direction of variation under which f should be invariant. So in addition to the fact that we are restricting ourselves to this hypersurface, we can only consider some particular kind of function which are independent of some direction, variations. So let me draw some kind of caricature. That is, we started out with some phase space M, and we restricted ourselves to some particular hypersurface set by phi equal zero. So we started out with 2m dimensional space, we restricted ourselves to phi equals 0. But on this phi equals 0 hypersurface, there is a flow. Then the flow generated by phi, so these flows are generated by vector v, whose components are minus del q of phi and del p of phi. So we have flow along, and then any physical observer should be independent of the direction of this flow. So if you evaluate f over here, and if you evaluate f over here, these should be of the same value. So that means f is independent, physical observable is independent of where you evaluate along this line. So that means that this direction is, so for example, in the case of gauge theory, these are the directions generated by gauge transformation. So these directions are irrelevant as far as physical observable is concerned. So what you can do is, rather than considering this phi equals zero hypersurface as your physical space, it's better that you introduce some kind of cuts here, and then just consider intersection of this flow with this particular cut. And then for if you choose this cut so that this flow intersects with this cut only once, then there will be a unique point on each trajectory, and we can say that the f is a function on these points, intersection of this flow with this. So that means that the actual physical subspace is just along this this green line, because green line has to first of all stay in phi equals zero hypersurface, and moreover, if this flow intersects with this green line once and only once, then each point on the green line specifies unique flow. Along each flow, physical observer takes unique value. So therefore, each physical observer takes unique value as a function of this green line. So we would like to cut out such green line. Okay, so if you, after you do that, so how many constraint you need to impose to cut out this line? Well, because flows in general are in n-dimensional direction, so you need to introduce n conditions to cut those through. So what you do is, if you want, you have phi, constraint phi, corresponding to those constraints, we introduce another function, p and q, so that chi A is equal to zero imposes this the cutout of this green line, green hypersurface. So what we want to do is to choose as many the function whose number is as many as the number of constraints, so that the flow generated by phi intersect transversely through the surface cut out by chi equals zero. That condition is nothing but the condition that determinant of Poisson bracket of phi with chi as n by n matrix is non-zero. If this condition is satisfied, then suppose this green line is a hypersurface with chi equals zero, the flow generated by phi intersects that transversely. So what we see is that we can, in order, if you are interested in, just restrict yourself to evaluating physical observables of the system, then we can restrict it to some subspace M star of the phase space M. Where both phi and chi are equal to zero. Okay? That's clear? Now, this is an even dimensional space, because we started out with two M dimensional space. We had N constraint here, and we have yet another N constraint here, so we have total two N constraint. So M star is 2m minus n dimensional space. And it turned out that this space is a nice phase space. That is that you can actually introduce a Poisson bracket on this subspace. So let me describe that. So I'm going to the right side of the blackboard. So we can do that in a full generality, and so that leads to the notion of Dirac bracket, but that would take us too long time. So let's, for simplicity, assume that we are able to choose this new set of constraints so that they commute with each other. So let's assume chi A, chi B is equal to zero. Well, this is not, this does not lose much generality. In fact, if they are not zero, there is a sort of way to smooth deal with things so that you can actually, you can combine chi with phi in such a way that you end up with something like that. So let's assume from the beginning that we have chosen the set of new constraints so that phi and chi are equal to zero. On the other hand, oh, I forgot to say, Poisson bracket, obviously here we are in a situation where Poisson bracket of phi and chi do not vanish. So, so therefore, phi equals zero, chi equals zero, if you impose them simultaneously, those constraints are no more first class. So, not surprisingly, these are called the second class constraints. So now we are considering second class constraints where Poisson bracket is not consistent with the constraint. So these are second class constraints. Chi themselves are first classes, and phi themselves are first class. But if we want to impose both phi and chi, this becomes second. Okay, but anyway, so chi's commute with each other, let's assume that. So chi is a function of p and q, and they commute with each other. Since they commute with each other, Poisson commute with each other, we can always find canonical transformation, symplectic coordinate transformation, in such a way that, so we start with phase space M, which had M P's and M Q's. If we have functions that commute with each other, we can always find symplectic transformation so that the first N momenta are equal to chi. That is, that there is some canonical transformation or symplectic transformation. That there is the first p's are actually equal to chi's. And of course there are other p's. And so we have the rest, and then there is a canonically conjugate momenta q, whatever that is. And then we have a rest of the coordinate and momenta, which let's denote as P star and Q star, where S goes now from 1 to M minus N. Okay? So we can choose coordinate of the phase space in this way. Okay? So now, so what we see? Well, first of all, imposing chi equals 0 is absolutely easy. We just have to say P equals 0. How about imposing condition that phi is equal to zero? Well, we see that the determinant of phi A chi B is not equal to zero, but we have chosen symplectic transformation so that chi and p are the same. So this is equal to determinant of phi A pb. What's that? Well, that's easy to evaluate, because Poisson bracket, as you remember, is del Q F del P of G minus del Q of G del P of F. So if G is P itself, this will be zero because P, variation of P with respect to Q is zero. This will be Kronecker delta. And so we just have Q derivative of F. So this is is equal to determinant of derivative phi A with respect to QB. So if you have a set of functions, so we are in a situation, where determinant of del phi A del Q B is not equal to zero. So this is a situation probably you have learned in your undergraduate course of calculus where you can use inverse function theory. Suppose you have a set of function phi which which are function of Q which satisfies this property. What it means is that if you can solve phi equals zero. So for example, if this is a single valued function, what it means is that we have a function phi of Q and its derivative is non-zero. So that means that if you want to find a condition that phi equals zero here, there is a unique value of Q. Right? So this is a famous inverse function theory. So if this is true, then it means that QA can now be expressed as a function of Q star T star. Because we can solve this. Because we are setting P equals zero already. So that means that phi is now a function of Q star and T star. And then this condition guarantees for you that we can solve phi equals zero as a function of P star and Q star. So let me go to the left end of the blackboard. So where we are. So we started out with 2M dimensional phase space. So we had two things. We had the constraint phi equals zero. And then we have the constraint chi is equal to zero in such a way that the Poisson brackets are non-trivial. They are first class. So then what we did was, and then I assume that chi is equal to zero for simplicity, but we can relax this condition if you want. And then what we found was that if these chi's commute with each other, we can make a symplectic transformation so that Q is equal to chi. And then we have to still solve the condition that the Q star P star vanishes, where Q is a conjugate of P and Q star and P star are the rest of the coordinate. But what we see is that this condition is equivalent to the condition that determinant of del phi del q is non-zero, so therefore this can be solved as qa is equal to qa times as a function of q star and p star. Okay? So that means that the solution to this equation is at least locally uniquely parameterized by this rest of the coordinate, Q star and P star. And Q star and P star are chosen so that they are canonically conjugate to each other. So what we have seen is that there's a natural symplectic structure, Poisson structure on M star. M star is now phase space. With Q star and P star as a natural canonical coordinate. Okay? So this procedure is called symplectic reduction. That you start with M, and then we have the first class constraint phi equals zero. And then we introduce additional condition chi equals zero, to get new phase space, so this was initially 2m dimensional, and we had n constraint, and then we have 2m minus n dimensional space. This procedure is called symplectic reduction. This procedure can be done whenever you have a phase space and whenever you have some group acting on the phase space in such a way that it is compatible with Poisson bracket, or stated another way, in such a way that it is a canonical transformation. So namely, whenever you have phase space M, and then there is a group G acting on that phase space in such a way that it is its action is canonical, that is that it acts as a symplectic transformation, then we can always do that. That is that if you have a canonical transformation, it is a general theory of phase space or Hamiltonian system, that whenever you have symplectic transformation, you can always find a generator whose Poisson bracket with other variables generates that gauge symplectic transformation. So these are called moments. So these are called generators. So these are generators of G. So these are called generators because if you have other functions, function of M, then Poisson bracket of phi with that function generate this transformation G. So what you do is that if you have that generator, their Poisson bracket closes among themselves, and that comes from the fact that you started out with a group G. So group structure guarantees that this is a first class constraint. So now we have a first class constraint. So what you do, just like we did over here, we started out with a constrained surface of pi equal zero. So we consider a subspace where pi is equal to zero. And then you can show that G action also acts on M naught. So that means that we can consider quotient space M over G. And it turns out this space is actually the same as M star that we have been talking about. You see, we are using group twice, because suppose this group is n-dimensional. Suppose we are considering some continuous group transformation. So this is a Lie group, and so suppose it's an n-dimensional space. Then you have n generator. Setting phi equals zero reduces the phase space dimension by n. Suppose you further divide this, consider this quotient where you divide this constrained subspace by G again, and again reducing n dimensions. So I ended up with 2m minus 2n dimensional subspace. So even dimensional space, turns out that there's a natural Poisson bracket. In fact, this is exactly the same thing as we were doing over here. You have a question?
So the orbits of the G action on M naught are precisely these trajectories?
Right. So that's what I was saying, because I was drawing this trend, so we had this phase. So what he was asking about was that I was drawing this picture where you have M, we have this subspace phi, and then we have this flow. Okay. So when we consider quotient, what we mean is that we take each of these trajectory as single point, right? That's what we mean by quotient. These flows are generated by phi. We call phi as generator of G because Poisson bracket of phi with function generates the action of G, which is exactly this flow. Okay. So that's why. And then here we have chosen explicitly function chi to parameterize this flow. But more abstractly, we don't have to do that. We just have to say that we just consider quotient of M0. This subspace is M0. And then we are taking quotient, which is just take representative of each of these trajectories, which is the same as taking this quotient, which I call M star, which is this M star that we have been talking about. So you can always find symplectic phase space, 2m minus 2n dimensional, 2m minus 2n dimensional phase space if you have G action. So this is called symplectic reduction or Marsden-Weinstein quotient, this space. A very natural notion whenever you have symmetry action on the phase space. In particular, so that's coming back to our original setup, you have a gauge theory where you start out with phase space, which is a configuration space of AI and EI, the conjugate electric field. That's the phase space, original phase space of the gauge theory. We had a constraint that DI of EI is equal to zero, that's phi, and that's generate gauge transformation. Gauge transformation is an infinite dimensional group. So what you want to do is start with infinite dimensional space of configuration of E and A, gauge field A, special component of gauge field A, and its conjugate electric field. Impose condition that generator of gauge transformation is called zero, and divide the subspace by further gauge transformation. What's chi here? Well, chi are gauge conditions. You know that when we try to deal with gauge theory, we often impose what's called gauge condition. That is a set of conditions that sort of remove the degrees of freedom to do the gauge transformation. There are names like Landau gauge or Coulomb gauge. Those are arbitrary choices, but with the condition that it is not invariant under gauge transformation. That's the same statement as, that's the same thing as what we did here, where we have chosen chi to be transverse to the trajectory generated by phi. Namely, that being transverse means that it's not invariant under transformation. So in particular, in the case of gauge theory, we choose this condition so that they are not invariant under gauge transformation. They cut through the trajectory of gauge transformation. So this is exactly the correct, appropriate language to understand the gauge, the field, the configuration space structure of gauge field. Okay. What we do in gauge fixing is exactly this Marsden-Weinstein quotient procedure. Now, if you have taken some course on quantum field theory, this is not the end of the story. You have encountered the notion of Faddeev-Popov determinant when you studied quantization of gauge theory. Now, I would like to give you a geometric explanation of the appearance of the Faddeev-Popov ghost determinant. Okay, so what's Faddeev-Popov determinant? Well, you know that if you want to quantize some dynamical system, there are many ways of doing it. Feynman's way of doing it is basically integrate over trajectory in phase space. So therefore, the way you want to understand quantization in Feynman's way, you want to understand measure in the phase space. So we have this physical phase space, which is M star. So therefore, if you have a physical, if you have a dynamical system with constraint, but if you know that physical phase space is M star, the natural thing to do would be to define space of physical paths, namely paths in the physical phase space. Namely, we should be considering integral with measure omega star, which is the measure on this physical phase space. That's what we should be doing. So if you can do path integral on the physical phase space, then you have nothing to worry about. You can just do that And then you don't have to worry about further Popov determinant or anything like that. The problem is that it is often awkward to do that because you have to get, you have to sometimes you lose lots of symmetries in the system, and sometimes it's more convenient if you can write the path integral in the original phase space M rather than this reduced space. And so you may want to write it as integral over the original phase space, which are like that. That's easy to do because you can just put delta function over here to impose a constraint to reduce that. So clearly, M star, omega star, so if you define, so we can write this as delta function of Q is equal to QA of Q star P star delta of PA is zero. We impose this condition times this DQI, DPI. So you have M DP, DP and M DQ. You set first P to be equal to zero. You set the second Q to be function of P star and Q star. That just gives you this back. So you can write it in this way. You start. You can just do this Feynman path integral over this original phase space, but then you impose these conditions. But this may still be awkward because here you have to solve the constraint for Q and write that as a function of Q star and P star. You may want to write this in terms of the original set of constraints. That's where the Fadeev-Popov will come in, because you have to make change of variables to do that, and there is a Jacobian associated to that. So I'm going to the left end of the blackboard. Okay. So what I want to do is to write these delta functions. You have two kinds of delta function. The delta function where QA is equal to QA of P star, Q star. And then you have delta function of PA is equal to zero. So there are two delta functions. But I want to rewrite it in other things. I want to write it as delta function of phi A is equal to zero, and delta function of chi A is equal to zero. These are selecting the same subspaces, as I discussed earlier, because chi is equal to p itself, so chi equals 0 is the same as p equals 0, and phi equals 0 is solved by this equation, so these are the same spaces, but different with respect to different variables, so I have to introduce Jacobian for this change of variable, so I have to multiply determinant of phi a by qp, qb. We have to do that. So if I do that, then this is an equality. But now I know that this is equal to determinant of phi A chi B. Okay. So what we see is that omega star, which is the phase space volume of the physical phase space, is now equal to delta of chi, delta of phi, times determinant of phi and chi, times the phase space volume of the original big phase space. And moreover, this can also be turned into something else, which is an integral of a Lagrange multiplier, because basically delta function condition can be enforced by integrating over Lagrange multiplier. So we can write that as an integral over Lagrange multiplier. So this is sometimes more convenient, because now we see that in the case of gauge theory, for example, this is a special component of gauge field. This is a time component. So if you write them together, it looks more Lorentz invariant. And we just have to impose the gauge fixing condition. Great thing about this is that gauge fixing condition here can be any condition, as far as it cuts through the gauge fixing condition, the gauge transformation transversely. It can be Landau gauge, Coulomb gauge, or any gauge you like. And then multiply this determinant. Of course, this is a Fadeff-Popov determinant. So, from this perspective, the Fadeff-Popov determinant that we have in the gauge fixing procedure of gauge theory is nothing but the Jacobian for the change of variable to naturally define integral over physical phase space out of the original redundant unconstrained phase space volume. So, any question? So far I have only looked at local structure of the phase space or configuration space of gauge field. So for example, I assumed that the condition chi equals zero cuts through the trajectory generated by gauge transformation transversely. It's easy to come up with something like that locally. Often globally, there can be some problem in finding appropriate chi. So these are all sort of structures that is sort of local in the gauge field configuration. Now, so I have about 18 minutes. So in the remaining time, I would change the subject a little bit and discuss more about global structure of global geometric structure of gauge field configuration. So global geometry, or more like topology of gauge field configuration. So, by that I mean the following. So first of all, let's try to think what is the topology of the total space of gauge field configuration. Okay, so what would it be like? Well, let's for simplicity, so we can consider gauge field configuration on arbitrary four-dimensional manifold. But to be specific, let's consider S4. So let's consider gauge theory or gauge field. On four dimensional sphere. So we Euclideanize the Minkowski space, we add a point at infinity to compactify that Euclidean space to a sphere. Okay? So and then let's call A to be configuration space. So configuration of any gauge connection. The physical configuration space is A divided by G, where G is gauge transformation, the group generated by gauge transformation. So if you consider arbitrary configuration of A, divide that with arbitrary configuration of G, then that is a gauge field configuration. Now, A is an infinite dimensional space, G is an infinite dimensional space. You divide infinity by infinity is a dangerous thing. But in fact, there are various nice features about this space. So remember that we had a notion of homotopy type when we discussed the homotopy group. That is that sort of that sort of invariant and continuous transformation of the space. And it turns out that this infinite dimensional space is actually homotopic to nice finite dimensional space. You can show that A over G, this infinite dimensional space of gauge invariant configuration of a gauge field on S4, is homotope to omega. Somehow I didn't erase the blackboard well, I don't know why. A, well, this chalk doesn't write well. Omega 3 of G. Well, what's this omega 3 of G? Well, actually, this is still not a finite dimensional space, but it's a space of map from S3 to G. So still in three dimensional space, but actually, as we will see, this is simpler space to deal with. This is a configuration space of gauge field on S4, and this space is a space, if you like, of gauge transformation on S3. And the reason that we can do that is that if you have a fiber vector bundle over four sphere, but natural thing to do is to cut that into half across the equator. And upper hemisphere is a four-dimensional disk, which is contractible. Lower hemisphere is, again, disk which is contractible. So therefore, gauge field, the structure of vector bundle over northern hemisphere and southern hemispheres are sort of trivial. The only non-triviality comes from the information about how you glue them together. And that is carried by this information. So all other informations are contractible. So therefore, the homotopic type of space of gauge field configuration, modular gauge transformation, is the same as the homotopic type or homotopy type of a map from S3 to G. Okay, but this, the fun does not end here. That is that you can actually compute homotopy of this space in a nice way. Homotopy group of this space in a nice way. And to do that, I'd like to point out the following interesting fact. That is that if I consider, I'm going to the left end of the blackboard, that is that, suppose you consider the following space. Suppose G is a group, and suppose we consider a map from three sphere, an M-dimensional sphere to G, and suppose you consider a map from N-dimensional sphere to the space group generated by a map from M-dimensional sphere to group, to the group G. You can show that this is homotopy. This is homotope to omega of n plus m of g. Okay? So this in particular means that if you want to compute pi n of omega m of g, it is the same as pi of n plus m of g. And this we know how to compute in many cases. So that means that you can actually compute the homotopy group of this infinite dimensional space of map from M dimensional sphere to the group. Okay, this turned out to be an extremely useful idea. So let me illustrate a few applications of this identity. Okay, so I'm going to the middle of the blackboard to go to the right a little bit. Okay, so let's do some examples of how you utilize this kind of idea. The first example, so for the rest of the example, let's assume that group is SUN, where we can use Bott periodicity that we studied in the last lecture. Bott periodicity exists for SO and SP, and similar thing applies there. So we know pi naught of omega 3 of G. What is this? Well, if I use this identity, This is the same as pi 3 of g. And if I use Bopp periodicity, we can show that this is equal to z for if n is greater than or equal to 2. N is n of S n. So that means that omega, this means that this space, which by the way is the same as same homotopy type as gauge field configuration for S4, has disjoint component. Because you have not, remember, pi naught count the number of disjoint components of the space you are considering. And here you are saying that pi naught is parameterized by integer. So that means that A, so this is of the same homotopy type as A over G. So that means that gauge field configuration on 4 sphere has many disjoint components. Those are all parameterized by integers. So that means that there's an integer that parameterizes the disjoint component of the gauge field configuration for S4. We already know, we have already encountered such object. That's the second Chern number that we discussed. Remember, we discussed the characteristic class in the last quarter, and I introduced a notion of second Chern number, which is 1 over 8 pi squared over integral of S4 of trace of F wedge F. Miraculously, this turned out to be integer, and this is a gauge invariant, topological invariant, homotopical invariant quantity of the gauge field configuration. This is an integer, and since this is invariant under continuous deformation of gauge field configuration, so the fact that you have integer parameterizing gauge field configuration means that gauge field configuration has to be divided into disjoint component parameterized by this integer. This analysis shows that this is a complete classification of the disjoint union, disjoint component, that each disjoint component is parameterized by Chern number and only by the second Chern number. Okay. Now, the index theorem discussed in the lecture 8 tells you also that this number is related to the number of Dirac operator capture that gauge field. So this z, which is parameterized by pi 3 of SUN, which parameterized pi 3 of SUN, actually counts the number of zero mode of Dirac operator on S4. So that's one of the applications of this identity. Let's discuss another application. Let's discuss a couple of other applications. I'm going to the right side of the blackboard. Okay, so let's move on to, so here we discussed pi 0 of omega 3. Let's consider pi 1 of omega 3 of g, which is pi 4 of g. Okay, so what's pi 4 of g? Well, again, we can use both periodicity. Pi 4 of SUN is actually trivial for n greater than 3. So that means that there is no, so that means that space of gauge field configuration is actually simply connected. There is no non-contractible loop in the gauge field configuration on 4 sphere. So if you have a continuous loop, continuous family of gauge field configuration which come back to the same point, you can always contract that loop to a point. If we are considering gauge field with gauge group SUN with n greater than 3. This again follows from the Bott periodicity that we discussed in the last lecture. There is, however, an exception to this. This is important. Pi 4 of SU2 is not trivial, but it's Z2. This, because both periodicity works only for sufficiently large rank. So this turned out to be an exception to that. This is very interesting that this means various things, one of which is the following. So pi 4 of SU2 can be considered in various different ways. One way is like that, but another way is it's a gauge transformation on 4 sphere, because pi 4 classifies homotopy type of map from 4 sphere to SU2, which is nothing but the gauge space of gauge transformation on phosphere. We have S4 mapped to SU2. We are considering gauge theory on S4. So there is a homotopy type of this map. So that means that there is a gauge transformation. There's a gauge transformation for on S4, which cannot be continuously deformed to an identity. There is a topologically non-trivial gauge transformation you have for SU2 gauge theory, but not for higher rank gauge theory. For higher rank gauge theory, pi 4 is always trivial, so that means that any gauge transformation on phosphere can always be continuously deformed to a trivial gauge transformation. This shows that that is not the case for the case of SU2, that there is actually a Z2 value, so that means that there is a class of transformation, so this consists of only two elements, 1 and minus 1. If you consider there is a class of gauge transformation that can always be contracted to 1, but there is another class of transformation which can be continuously transformed into each other, but not to an identity. Oh, this binary thing. It turns out that there is a computation that detects that. That is the following, that if you consider a chiral fermion, so that is a Dirac fermion, which is an eigenstate of gamma phi, and say plus, for example, if I consider a chiral fermion, and then compute the determinant of the Dirac operator for that, and suppose that chiral fermion is doublet representation of that SU2, then you can show that the determinant of Laplacian changes the sign if you do the gauge transformation with minus 1 over here. And so that's consistent, because that's possible because you can have topologically non-trivial gauge field configuration. It's not something like that cannot happen if gauge transformation can be continuously deformed to identity, because the sign cannot go back to the original one. So this is only possible because of this non-triviality. But if you have that theory is inconsistent, because that means that determinant of Laplacian for that chiral fermion is not gauge invariant. So you cannot actually consistently gauge and quantize it. If you want to enforce gauge symmetry by smearing out over gauge transformation, because the determinant of Laplacian changes sign, the partial function vanishes. So again, that's inconsistent. This was discovered by Edward Witten, so it's called Witten anomaly. So the Witten anomaly is a very curious phenomenon that happens only in SU2 gauge theory, but not for SUN theory. Witten proved, therefore, that if you have SU2 gauge theory with odd number of chiral fermions that are in adjoint representation of SU2, that theory is inconsistent. Let me give you a final example of application of homotopy in this kind of context. So we looked at pi 3, pi 4, so it's natural to look at pi 5. So let's look at pi 5 of G, and that is equal to pi 2 of omega 2 of G, omega 3 of G. So now I'm looking at, therefore, so omega 3 is a homotopy type of configuration space of gauge field on 4 sphere. And now I'm asking whether there is a 2 sphere in that configuration space that can be shrunk to a point. You can show that for G is equal to SUN, N is greater than 3, then this is going to be Z. Again, for N equal to 2, it is Z2. In both cases, this is non-trivial. So pi 5 of SUN is non-trivial, and that is related to the fact that in the configuration space of gauge field, there is a 2 sphere that you cannot shrink to a point. So I have only 30 seconds, so I cannot explain it, but this is related to what is called non-abelian anomaly. That is that if you have chiral fermions coupled to gauge theory, gauge field, then sometimes this there is no way to impose gauge invariance consistently. That computing determinant of Dirac operator shows the determinant is not the gauge invariant. There is an obstruction for imposing gauge invariance for the determinant, and that can be detected by having this two-sphere in the configuration space of the gauge field. Okay? So that's related. So you see that by using this kind of understanding of homotopy type of gauge field configuration globally, you can detect various interesting features, some of which is actually giving you obstruction against quantizing gauge theory consistently. Those are important things to know, of course, because we want to know which gauge theories are consistently quantizable and which are not. And this gives you robust obstruction against those things. So the final question for today is to repeat this analysis in other space-time dimensions. Okay, so that's your homework. So that's it for today.